Where do you go to a doctor? I go for medicine. Where do you go to a teacher? I go for education. What are you going to your guru for? My life should be happy, sir. I have daughters to be married, sons to be educated and put in good jobs. That is enough. After all, what are we to expect? Even from a guru. When God has not blessed me, what can a guru do for me? We are negating the Vedic truth, the Vedic statement, the truth that God Himself says, I am here as your guru. The guru is not God, but God is the guru, having achieved the form of a guru. As He took so many avatars for Loka Kshema or for the, you know, evolution of the earth, for its protection, for its growth. Unfortunately, we have not, in our Sahaj Marg training courses, in our lectures, in CREST, we have not paid, perhaps we were not even aware of the importance of what our expectations can do to limit us in this world and in the next, in this life and in the next. So I think it is time to wake up to the reality that as I see, that is what I will see. As I hear, that is what I will hear. As I touch, that is all I will touch. If I touch my guru thinking he is a villager, he is a villager. If I think that he is erudite and touch him, I will get wisdom. Because, like the spectrum, seven colors, they are seven only for convenience, but it's an infinite range through this to this. Similarly, what he is, it's an infinite range from here to there. What he says, if I said, okay, what has he, I mean, he's only sixth class. He has himself said, I may be fifth or sixth class. What do you expect to hear? Let us go and have a samosa. Many people have done this. Babuji starts talking and they go for samosas, paan in Shahjahanpur. And when they come back, and some of those who have been there patiently waiting for whatever comes from the guru, and they are grateful, they are ennobled, they are made more wise, they are made more accepting, in the sense that I am able to accept more after I have listened to him. Not because I expect more, because my capacity has been increased by what he has said, by the way he has looked at me, and the atmosphere that he has created. And when they come back, they say, oh, how I wish I had not gone. Too late. Because even if you hear it from a tape recorder, his same words, they are not the same. You know, when my grandson was 3 or 4 years old, I used to bring from him from abroad discs, CDs with sounds of whales, sounds of water, sounds of birds, and he used to listen to them half an hour, maybe sometimes more after lunch. But when you see a whale, it is something else. When you hear a bird sitting on a tree, it is something else. There is the difference between what is recorded, which is in the past, and what I hear directly now, which is in the present, in its proper setting, in its atmosphere. I understood why Babuji said, even if your house and my house are separated by just one wall, still the Abhyasi must come to the Guru for a week every year. Precisely to, you know, get this soaking, drenching in that atmosphere, living with him. It's very vital. Then you are able to forget. You know, when you look at a pond from outside, you may think it's a dirty village pond. You may think there may be an alligator in it or fish. You see some, you know, this algae on top and you think it could be dirty. The beauty of it is only when you get into it. Or I won't even say beauty, the reality of it is only when you get into it. and then you are reluctant to come out. So if you want to know what is spirituality, what is the Guru, you must be prepared to drown in His presence. But those who go just for a cursory glance to evaluate Him and to judge Him by what He says, what He does, it is like an ant trying to measure an elephant. We are not worried about the three blind men, you know. They at least saw something. One blind man saw an elephant as a pillar, another saw it as a wall, third saw it as a rope. They saw something. But if an ant tries to judge an elephant, it doesn't see anything. Because it's just going on and on and on. Where is the elephant, it says, you know? On the elephant, and yet it says, where is the elephant? So this is the problem of Abhyasis, especially, you know, I am sorry to say, intellectual people who come with their intellects. They are not intelligent. I mean, they are not wise, they are only intelligent. And here intelligence is not enough. Can intelligence evaluate beauty? Can it appreciate a painting? Will it look at a painting as an object of art governed by this rule and that rule, colors? Picasso puts together something, it's great. Rembrandt puts together something, it is great. What is the greatness in it that intelligent people will not perceive ever? It is what the soul sees. And the soul must be permitted to see before it can see. And what is it that prevents the soul from seeing? The ego. He says, let me see. Because the ego's existence depends on its retaining its supremacy over everything else. Therefore, the approach of the ego, whether in the material life or in spiritual life, is always against the interests of the soul. When we tell Abhyasis, don't be arrogant, don't be proud, don't, put your ego as your barrier between yourself and others. It is because their spiritual life is always harmed, perhaps even condemned. So you may ask what all this has to do with attitude. Well, because these things govern our attitude. My attitude is created by my ego. The ego says, he is no use as a guru. Why are you leaving religion? Because when we are religious, the ego is safe. The ego says, good, you have done your duty today by God. You have done your worship. Because the ego is not hurt. On the contrary, the ego is strengthened by puja, by recitation. I wonder whether anybody would ever realize the harm that religious practices, not religion, religious practices do to us. Because we get into the habit of repeated repetitions of a name. And as Babuji said to a boy who accosted him in, I think, New York, and he said, can you give me a mantra? He said, repeat your own name. That's a joke. What is a mantra? It's a repetition. You know, the great Valmiki, who was a gunda, who was a thug, who used to rob people traveling through the jungles, waylay them, dacoits. He wanted a mantra and he said, Ram, Ram. No? But he could not say Ram, Ram. So he said, say Mara, Mara. It just happens that Mara, Mara is the opposite of Ram, Ram. You say Ram, 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 it becomes Ram, 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 you know. It also exposes the foolishness that you turn it upside down and say the same thing and it still works. We have been misled by our readings of these Puranas, which says it was, when he said Ram, 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 it only became Ram, Ram, therefore it worked. As Babuji said, it worked because it was a repetition of the same thing again and again ad nauseam, and it dulled your head. So that is the truth of mantras and repeated recitation of mantras. People who write in books, you know, every day 10 pages, Ram, Ram, or Jai Sri Ram, Jai Sri Ram, Jai Sri Ram. I had a relative who filled up many notebooks like this. And he thought he was holy, he was religious. But there was no change in his character. He was still angry, he still shouted at his wife. He had no friends. So the proof of what we do must come from outside, not of what I think of myself. I am great. Ravana said it. Hiranyakashipu said it. Kamsa said it. And what happened? The avatars came. So you see, religious practices, I again emphasize the difference between religion per se, the teachings, and the way it is practiced. Religion says humility, love, compassion, charity, and these are enshrined in the practices that are recommended to us. Give, love, accept. No? Give, love, accept. One of the greatest things, one of the greatest difficulties is to accept, whether it is help, whether it is, you know, no, I have. Would you like, no, we have enough at home. To accept with grace is a sign of humility. People don't know. We are always saying, no, I have. Sir, would you like an apple? No, I have. I have dozens of them at home. And in giving, it is a sign of ego. We are not giving with love or out of charity or compassion or as a sharing between ourselves. I am feeding. And God says, aha. And one day your larder is clean, your table is empty. And then your ego says, don't ask for help, because I have never asked for help in my life. I have always given help.